The oath of vengeance, or blood vengeance, was an oath that members of the church took as part of the endowment ceremony in the temple from 1845 to the early 1930s. In this oath, members of the church vowed that they would pray for God to avenge the blood of Joseph and Hiram Smith, who were killed in 1844. In the temple, the officiator would say, "You and each of you, do covenant and promise that you will pray and never cease to pray to Almighty God, to avenge the blood of the prophets upon this nation, and that you will teach the same to your children and to your children's children, unto the third and fourth generation." The word prophets in this oath refers to Joseph and Hiram Smith, who were killed in Carthage jail in 1844. The word nation in the oath refers to the United States. In 1845, Brigham Young, the successor of Joseph Smith, instituted the oath of blood vengeance in the Nauvoo Temple endowment ceremony. At the time, many members wanted revenge for the killing of the Smiths. Blood vengeance doctrine is similar to the blood atonement doctrine that existed at the same time, which stated that there are sins for which the atonement of Christ does not cover, and the person must shed their own blood to obtain forgiveness. On April 6, 1853, Brigham Young said, "Before the Nauvoo Temple was completed, Joseph was murdered. Murdered at sunlight, under the protection of the most noble government that then existed, and that now exists on our earth. Has his blood been atoned for? No. And why? A martyr's blood to true religion was never atoned for on our earth. No man, or nation of men, without the priesthood, has power to make atonement for such sins. The souls of all such, since the days of Jesus, are under the altar, and are crying to God, day and night, for vengeance. And shall they cry in vain? God forbid. He has promised he will hear them in his own due time, and recompense a righteous reward." Brigham Young also said, "A person who has committed a sin that he knows will deprive him of that exaltation which he desires, and that he cannot attain to it without the shedding of his blood, and also knows that by having his blood shed he will atone for that sin, and be saved and exalted with the gods. Is there a man or woman in this house but what would say, 'Shed my blood that I may be saved and exalted with the gods'? All mankind love themselves, and let these principles be known by an individual, and he would be glad to have his blood shed. That would be loving themselves, even unto an eternal exaltation. Will you love your brothers or sisters likewise, when they have committed a sin that cannot be atoned for without the shedding of their blood? Will you love that man or woman well enough to shed their blood? That is what Jesus Christ meant." Also in 1845, Heber C. Kimball, one of the original apostles of the LDS Church, and first counselor to Brigham Young, wrote in his diary that in the temple he had covenanted, and will never rest until those men who killed Joseph and Hiram have been wiped out of the earth. Annalisa Young, one of Brigham Young's 55 wives, wrote in her autobiography, "We swore that we would use every exertion to avenge the death of our prophet Joseph Smith and his brother Hiram upon the Gentile race, and to teach our children to foster this spirit of revenge also." Later in 1889, Abraham H. Cannon, son of George Q. Cannon, who was an apostle for the LDS Church, wrote in his journal what his father had told him about the oath of vengeance. He said, "About 4:30 p.m., this meeting adjourned and was followed by a meeting of Presidents Woodruff, Cannon and Smith and brothers Lyman and Grant. In speaking of the recent examination before Judge Anderson, Father said that he understood when he had his endowments in Nauvoo, that he took an oath against the murderers of the prophet Joseph as well as other prophets, and if he had ever met any of those who had taken a hand in that massacre, he would undoubtedly have attempted to avenge the blood of the martyrs." Also in 1889, some members of the church who had emigrated to the United States were on trial for their loyalty because they had taken the oath of vengeance in the temple. One such member, John Bond, testified, "The second one I was put under was to avenge the blood of the prophets against the government of the United States, teach that to my children and my children's children from generation to generation, and everlastingly keep them after them. The penalty, I believe, was that the heart, or the bowels, would be torn out, something to that effect, so far as my memory will carry me." Another member who testified in the trial, Bishop Andrew Cannon, said, "Well, as near as I can remember, I was sworn to avenge the blood of the prophets, that was understood indirectly, to refer to Joseph Smith. The understanding was that any parties who were guilty or consented to their death, as near as I understand it." Also John D. Lee, in his confession in his role in the Mountain Meadows massacre, said, "I believe then as I do now that it was the will of every true Mormon in Utah, at that time, that the enemies of the church should be killed as fast as possible, and that as this lot of people had men amongst them that were supposed to have helped kill the prophets in the Carthage jail, the killing of all of them would be keeping our oaths and avenging the blood of the prophets." In 1904, during the Reet Smoot hearings, other members of the church testified about the blood vengeance oath. J. H. Wallace Sr. testified, "That you and each of you will never cease to importune high heaven for vengeance upon this nation for the blood of the prophets who have been slain." August W. Lundstrom testified, "We and each of us solemnly covenant and promise that we shall ask God to avenge the blood of Joseph Smith upon this nation." There is something more added, but that is all I can remember verbatim. That is the essential part. It was in regard to teaching our children and children's children to the last generation to the same effect. Mrs. Annie Elliott said, 1. I remember, they told me to pray and never cease to pray to get revenge on the blood of the prophets on this nation, and also teach it to my children and children's children. Later in 1919, President Heber J. Grant organized a committee to revise the endowment session of the temple, and the blood vengeance oath was removed from the temple ceremony in the early 1930s.